Alejandra, how are you doing this morning?
Hi, Joshua. It's good. It's a really sunny day in the Netherlands, which has me a little bit freaked out. I don't trust it. I don't trust sunny weather in the Netherlands.
Yeah, that does sound suspicious, just the sound of it.
Yeah, it's kind of like the Netherlands is a weird place that it's always raining and it's always gloomy, and there is these rare days in which you have sun. And still, I keep expecting it to start bursting into water. That's my expectation, to be honest.
Nice. And I said good morning because it's morning here, but obviously out there it's evening, right? Or at least afternoon.
It's 6 p.m. right now.
6 p.m. Nice. Cool. Well, I guess with that, how about you introduce yourself a little bit, like just who you are, where you're at, what you do.
Yeah, so real quick about me, Alejandra Villacis, or Alex. I live in an English-speaking country, so I go by Alex for people for whom it's easier. I got tired of people mispronouncing my name, and then that, or getting the Lady Gaga song Alejandro sung at me. It happened way too many times. I got tired of it, and I was like, yeah, my grandparents call me Alex, so I will go by Alex. And what do? I am a graphic designer and service designer, which means that I don't design only visual things, but I also design services and products and stuff like that. That is something that I'm starting. I discovered that and just started this year. And yeah, I'm working on a couple projects on that, which is really fun. I live, like I said, in the Netherlands. This is the fourth country I've lived in. I was originally born. I was born in Ecuador. My mom was an immigrant. She moved to, my dad migrated to Honduras, where he met my mom, and then they both moved to Ecuador. Then my older sister and I were born, my younger sister as well. Then when I was 15, we moved to Mexico. And then when I was 18, we moved to Germany. And then I stayed there for longer, and I became a German citizen. And as soon as I got my passport, I moved to the Netherlands. It's weird. Like, I got my passport in February and I decided to move in April. I was like, yeah, I'm moving. And the reason I moved is because I had decided that I wasn't really happy at my full-time job. I mean, it was a great job. I still work for the company, but it felt like I wanted to do more and I wasn't satisfied creatively. And I said, you know what? I want to know what else there is in my field. I've never gone to university. I want to try it out. I'm a German citizen now. I don't have any restrictions. So I decided to move to the Netherlands to go to the Willem de Kooning Academy, which is a great design school here.
Wow. Yeah. No, that's awesome. That's a great synopsis of your path going from Ecuador all the way to the Netherlands. That's a big jump. But I guess going back to Ecuador, how much time did you spend in Ecuador?
So from the time I was born to when I was 15, and leaving was always the goal, kind of, because I went to a German school. So there are, for some reason, probably that has to do with World War II, because everything has to do with World War II. Germany has schools, like German schools, all over South America. And when I was 8, I was in an American school. I was in the Abraham Lincoln School, learning a lot of English from the time that I was 3 to the time that I was 8. And then one day my parents heard that there were openings in the German school in my city, in Guayaquil. And yeah, so it was this, they said, okay, let's take the girls. Let's see if they make it in. We kind of didn't, my older sister and me, we didn't. So my parents showed up with all our ribbons and all the awards and stuff, like very happy. And the principal of the school told them, so your daughters don't know how to count. And they're like, but they're really smart. They're like, we're not saying they're not smart. We're saying that the school they're in is not a good school, but we still want them. and my parents are thinking to themselves, if they did so poorly in the exam, why do they want them? It's like, well, the older one, which is my older sister, wouldn't give up the exam. The time was up, but she would not give up the exam until she finished it. And I didn't even try. I just gave the exam to the teacher, said, I don't know how to do this, and started talking to her, asking questions about the school, asking questions about the exam. So basically one of us was relentless and the other one was really curious, which they really liked. So they brought us in, and then we started learning German, both of us. And by the time that I was 12, my parents sent us to Germany for 7 weeks as an exchange program. So I was 12 and my sister was 13. And we fell in love with Germany. So from then on, the goal was to finish high school and eventually go to university in Germany. So the goal, that immigration was always part of the plan. And it did happen. It just took a different path.
Yeah, no, definitely. That's really cool. This is the first time I've heard of like German schools in South and Central America. I have heard of American schools, obviously. I just talked with the guy from Honduras who went to an American school out there. But the school that you were coming from, you said the education, I guess, you got there wasn't as good. Was it like a kind of a lower income type school, or?
I don't think so. I think it was more like the whole marketing thing of an American school. It's probably somebody who just wanted to use the tag that this is an American school, and that's why they called it the Abraham Lincoln School. And I don't think the school was bad. I just think it wasn't to the level of the German school. We had good things. For example, we had half days in English, half days in Spanish. So the kids that came out of there were fluent. And also we were eight and nine. So I don't know how much kids can learn at that time. I don't know if it got better eventually. I know the school is still open and I know that they do fine. But in Latin America, mostly like because we are upper middle class, we went to like private schools. It's all by private schools. I know that people that come out of there are okay, but I know also that the German school has a bit of a higher standard because it's partially funded by the German government. So if the school doesn't have a certain level, they will not fund it anymore. So they have to be very rigorous about who they let in. And if other schools will give you, like if you fail your year, they give you like 2 chances to make it, the German school will be like, no, sorry, but we cannot afford to keep students that are not up to par. So it's I think it's more rigorous standards, and they have different focus points. So there are schools that are more focused on the social aspects. The German school happens to be more focused on math and science than other schools. So yeah, it's about finding the one that fits you. And my parents realized quickly that my sister and I needed something more challenging. So when the German school said yes, so they need to even out. They need to take the summer, or in that case, the winter break, which is in our case, it's January, February, and March, and they need to go to tutors to get up to level. And in 3 months, my sister and I caught up with everybody else in the school. And yeah, we did great. So
that's awesome. That's awesome. And what did your parents do, or do they do?
So my dad is an engineer. He has an engineering degree in agronomy, and he's the CEO from a company in Mexico. COO. I don't know, like upper management of a company in Mexico that receives coffee, manufactures it, labels it, packages it, and then sells it to different coffee sellers around the world. So basically, yeah, coffee. And my mom studied communication. Then she stayed home with us when we were little. And after that, she had her own entrepreneurial things. Like she had her own businesses. She worked as a teacher for a while. And now she's focused on learning Dutch because she also lives in the Netherlands. So she can eventually work for the government, hopefully helping immigrants adapt to be living in the Netherlands. Because we realized that she has a particular set of skills, which is knowing how to immigrate for different countries.
Nice. Yeah, I might have to hit her up sometime.
Yeah, it's a process. It's a process. I was talking to somebody. I was talking to Dali from Dali Talks the other day, and we were talking about immigration, and she was saying, "Yeah, you have such an interesting life story." And I'm like, "Is it? It's just my kind of just my life." But then she was telling me there are people that have never changed cities or neighborhoods.
Yeah. So. Yeah, especially in like South and Central America and in Mexico, there's limitations. A lot of them.
Not just that. I mean, of course, there are the financial, like political, socioeconomical limitations. Of course, there's that. But there's also that I think that we're so entrenched in our communities and in our families that the idea of leaving them, it's completely foreign. So to give you an example, one of my cousins, she did a master's degree in Spain. And she decided that she wanted to go back and live in Ecuador. Because for her, not being close to her family, to her friends, and so on, was inconceivable. For me, it was more of, okay, so I've done it before. I'll be fine.
Yeah. It's definitely like a trait. Like, I think depending on the person, like whether you can or you can't, like, be away from, the tight-knit relationships sometimes that you create with your family. And that being said, like, you're so close in age to your sister. Were you guys pretty tight growing up?
With my older... So I have two sisters. My older sister is a year and a half older than me. There was no Netflix in the 90s, clearly. Children were just popping around the globe. We have a joke in my family that... So I'm the 12th from 13 cousins or 15 cousins or so on my dad's side. And we did the math and we were like, for 5 years, people were popping children like crazy because it's like all my dad's siblings. We were like doing the math and we were like, every 6 months, somebody was announcing they're pregnant. What's wrong with you people? But it was the 90s, the 80s and the 90s. But yeah, it was a whole thing. With my older sister, we were very competitive with each other because we have very opposing personalities. But it's the thing that we'll meet up. She lives in Germany. So we'll meet up, be like cats and dogs for one day. But then we're like, oh, you're my sister. I love you. And with my younger sister, we're pretty tight. She is 17 now, so she's in the teens. And yeah, we're just really close because she's very mature and not very childish, so we meet in the middle.
Nice, that's really cool. So you said you and your sister have very opposing personalities. Like growing up, like did you realize that early on? Like what's yours versus hers?
We always knew that my parents and we always knew that we were very opposed. My sister, she's classic older kid. She wants to control. She is very opinionative. She's very dominant and she's very strong in her opinions and she wants to impose them. I, on the other hand, classic second child, was very loose and very mellow and very like, yeah, okay, we're playing this now. Cool, we're playing this now. I'm good. It was very jolly and very like not caring, which meant that I was basically off the air. I was always like la 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 la, and she was more of let's get this done. So she always did better in school than I did because she was more focused and so on. So and more mature than I was, and now I'm still pretty childish. I still have like a jolly personality, but it's weird because we bring that out in each other. I was talking about it with my parents when we were in Mexico, saying like how I have lived with my sisters individually for longer than they have been together, but somehow they are more similar to each other in personalities.
Interesting.
Yeah, because from the time that I was, from being born to being, well, to 17, my older sister and I will live in the same house. We're always together. Then my sister went to Mexico, to Northern Mexico for a year. Then we moved out to Germany. Then we lived together, just her and I, for like 3 years until I moved out. I moved to Hamburg, to a different city for work. And so all that time, so from 0 to 24, we were always together mostly, or living in the same house. And then with my younger sister, so from the time she was born to then until she was 7, that's when they moved back to Ecuador. That's 7 years. And then in Rotterdam, I moved with my parents. When I first moved here, I lived with her for a year. Then we shared a room. And yes, I was 26 sharing a room with a 15-year-old. That was fun. Those were fun times. But yeah, so, and now, like, I'm staying in this apartment with her and went to Mexico together. So all around, I've spent more time with them separately together than they have had with each other. And still, they are more similar in personality. Like, little things. I wake up and I'm talking and I'm happy. And they're more like slow wake up and yeah. Everything. They're more determined and more cutthroat and more in their own space. We always joke that they're cats and I'm a dog. Basically.
I like that. No, I have a very similar experience with, you know, my older brother and myself. I'm kind of like the jolly, you know, creative one. He is kind of the more structured, you know, rule follower. And that being said, did that personality, the second kid, as you describe it, did that lend itself to being creative, like, right off the bat? Or do you remember, was that always a part of your childhood or yourself?
I think so. I think that I was always drawing. I was always, like, in my head making up stories, like making up games for to play by myself or with my sister. We used to play act out a lot, that I would tell her, okay, these are the characters, this is what we're doing, we have to just act it out, and just playing with invisible things. My parents, when I was little, they thought I was seeing ghosts because I said that I had a puppy, and I would say, like, no, mom, don't close the car door, my puppy needs to get on the car. Or saying, my little brother is sitting here because I really want her brother. And my parents looked at each other and said, she's either seeing ghosts or she's crazy. And they were like, okay, if she doesn't grow out of it, we have a problem. But if she grows out of it, it's fine. And yeah, so always in my head, just thinking and asking questions and drawing and doing music and stuff like that. So yeah, and then for a stint, because I was living in Latin America, and let's face it, creative professions are, I thought I really like design, but I don't want to be designing wedding invitations forever. And the creative professions were not a thing that I thought that I could do. So I said, okay, what else can I do? I could do like architecture, or I can do bioengineering for a while. And it wasn't until I failed at a German high school that I took a creative profession as something serious that I was going to do.
Wow. Okay. Yeah. And I was gonna ask that too. Like, you know, like you said, in Latin. I'm not familiar with the culture in Latin America, but generally, in the States, you know, yeah, the creative professions do seem kind of limiting, or like less possible, or less income, and you know, with parents, one of them in engineering and the other one, you know, communications is a relatively creative yeah. field. So I was wondering, so it sounds like it took you a while to realize that it was a possibility
that's the thing. It's not because my parents didn't tell me that I could do it. Like, my parents always told me, if you want to be a hairdresser, be a hairdresser. We just want to be the best hairdresser there is. So if nice. No matter what you do, do it, but you have to not be the best at it, but give it your all. Like, do it passionately, give it your all. And so that was always like their mantra. Like, we don't care what you do, just do it passionately and do it well and be a good person. But still in Latin America, like, creative professions, they're not well supported, or we're not well paid. It was never about prestige, really. It was more about what kind of future are you going to have? Or are you gonna get paid for this eventually?
Yeah, so it was coming from like outside of the family, like school and society and et cetera.
Yeah, it was more from not seeing it. Also not seeing people in creative professions being like, okay, this is something that you can do. Like, you have school fairs and you like meet doctors and you meet engineers and you meet whatever, but you like seeing a designer, seeing as somebody saying like, hey, this is how I do my job, that never really happened. So yeah. I keep thinking, maybe if I had met somebody in school that told me I do service design. This is what I do. It's a lot of creative thinking. It's knowing a lot. It's being curious about things. Maybe I would have landed on it earlier. But I think because we think designer, we think artist, and that's not necessarily aligned. To give you an example of how it is, every time I go to Ecuador for Christmas, we do Secret Santa in my family. It's something that we do because there's a lot of us. So a present for each is kind of impossible. So we do Secret Santa. And every time I participate, I get acrylics, paints, and canvas, and brushes and canvases. It's something I don't use, but I keep getting it because they associate, like I did back then, being a designer, it's being an artist. Being an artist means that you paint. And if you don't enjoy painting, I don't particularly enjoy it. Immediately you scratch that as that that's what it is. But it's kind of in the medical profession or in health that people think, oh, if you're in health, you're a doctor. There are 4 million professions inside the field that have nothing to do with patient care. Like maybe you are a geneticist and you never meet a patient, or maybe you're a nurse and you are all about patient care. So I think there's a gap there that needs to be open on what professions actually exist and what is available.
Yeah, I definitely agree with that. It does exist outside of like creative fields too. I feel like in engineering, you know, I have a background in engineering. People, you know, what's a civil engineer versus a mechanical engineer, or like a geotech versus a structural? And it's like, but as far as, you know, art and design, that is definitely true that people don't really understand the difference. You know, one's very structured, one's very loose, or one's in there's like a whole like spectrum in between.
I like to point out like the difference between an artist and a designer is that the artist pursues their own fascination, while the designer pursues a fascination from somebody else. So if you are an artist, like let's say topic of sustainability. And no, let's make it even smaller. Plastic in the ocean. Let's say plastic in the ocean is a thing that you're passionate about. If you're an artist, you will follow your own passion. If you're an artist, you will dive into a cave and see how much plastic you can find, and you'll try to date it and look at where the plastic came from or how it worked. And you'll make, let's say, an exhibition about it. If you're a designer, in like my case, a service designer, you would look at that information, collect that data, and see how you can propose a solution for that. Or you will talk to the people that have to do with the plastic, or you will point at the problem. So it really depends on what the end goal is, whether the end goal is to satisfy your own curiosity or is to satisfy the one from somebody else.
Yeah, that's a big deal. And I do a little bit of both, or I do a lot of one and a little bit of another, but deciding which one to go into is definitely a process of like figuring out and knowing yourself. So when you decide like, oh, it's possible to go into creative fields, did you know that about yourself, that you liked a certain design versus art?
I knew that I didn't want to do solely art, and also art and design, they're not mutually exclusive. Like they can combine, they can coexist. I think they coexist beautifully. And also being an artist is not like, what is an artist? Somebody that approaches things creatively and with a certain level of mastery, or with a level of beginner level. So you can be a surgeon and your tools are your brushes, and you can be an artist of cardiac services or cardiac surgeries, I don't know. But yeah, so you can be an artist in anything. It's just like we limit it to visual art when there are so many other types of art. But yeah, to answer your question, I was always attracted to design. When I was little, I had this book, Brown Bear. The man who wrote it and illustrated it just passed away. His name escapes me, but it will come back to me in a second. He also wrote the book, The Hungry Caterpillar. And I remember being really little and fascinated with that book because of how it was designed, because I thought how the animals were drawn was so quirky and interesting, and it was so textured, and the color combinations were so amazing, and I was fascinated by that. And or looking at my mom got us this illustration book. It's not a children book. It was like 101 stories and how it was illustrated, how the letters mixed into the images. And then we had this children's encyclopedia, and I was fascinated by how it was made, by how some pages were completely different than others, how every spread told a story about that particular topic. So I was always fascinated by it. I just couldn't give it a name. And by the time that I got into design, really, I remember that I was in, so when you move to Germany, when you want to go to school in Germany, Germany doesn't recognize any high school degrees that are not German. So they force you to make an extra year, which goes in a place called Studienkolleg, which is like the last year of high school. You're redoing the last year of high school. And in my head, I wanted to be an engineer back then. So I went to something called T-Course, which is technical course, in which you get math, physics, chemistry, and German, four subjects. And then at the end of it, you present a test, you pass it, then you can apply to university in Germany. I failed it miserably, like miserably. It was all my fault. I thought I was too smart to study. I got into Tetris at that time. It was awful. And I failed it and I got really depressed. And around that time, my sister had started medical school in Germany because she had done already a medical, 1 year of medical school in Mexico. So she could just swoop in. And we lived in the outskirts of town with my parents. And she said, hey, I want to move into the city center because I don't want to live in the suburbs. I want to enjoy my college experience. I want to live in the city center. You're not doing anything. You're very sad. How about we move in together to like the center of the city? And we did. And we just so happened to have moved across the street from a design school. Like across the street from a design school. I didn't even know it existed. Wow. And then I thought, okay, I have nothing to do now. I have to wait a year so I can retake the test. So, you know what? I will do design school for a year just because I have nothing else to do. Maybe I'll like do something fun, something that I enjoy doing. Worst case scenario, I'll learn something new. And I never left. And I loved it. And I realized that I had landed in the thing that I was supposed to do and that I enjoyed doing. And I never left.
That's awesome. Wow, yeah, that's such luck almost, right?
Yeah, exactly.
That's a great coincidence. So that's awesome. So once you're in school, I mean, you've been going to a German school for a long time, for a good amount of time now. How was it going to school in Germany with Germans?
I don't know. Honestly, I think I was lucky that the school I was in was really small. So I had very few classmates. I think we started as a class of 20 and we became a class of 8. Wow. So you had really a one-to-one connection with the teachers. There were a couple of teachers that were very attentive. Good intentions, I guess, saying like, if you need a dictionary, just let us know and you can bring one to class. And I'm like, no, I've spoken German for a while. I learned German for 7 years and now I live here, so I am fine, but still, thank you for asking. And yeah, Germans are very different. I had gone from Studienkolleg in which we were very international. Like you had the Muslim countries little group, you have the Asian countries little ball, you have the Latin American countries little ball, and then you have a bunch of Americans spread out everywhere. But yeah, so going from that to going to a full-on German school with only Germans, it was weird. It was different. It was a lot of adapting to how Germans are because they're very particular. Love them to death, German myself, but they're very particular people. So that was fun.
Yeah, there's something about like Germans, and I feel like other countries in that area, not so much like France, but more, more towards like the Netherlands and stuff, where mm-hmm. there's like very, very detail oriented, very type A, and I'm definitely not that. So what kind of stuff are they teaching in this little school? What kind of do you remember any like fun stuff that you're learning and doing?
Yeah, I remember like the thing that I like about that school and what I'm very grateful for is that they took the time to teach us the programs. Like, we had a class that it was only like, we had a class that was called Adobe, which we went from A to Z from Adobe Illustrator. Then next year is A to Z Photoshop. Then next year is A to Z InDesign. Then we're going to mix it all together. And we had that. We had a typography class that I really didn't like because the teacher sucked. But aside from that, it was nice. We had a drawing class in which we just drew. We had color theory class. We had a bunch of class very focused on getting the fundamentals of design. And then later we had typography again, but then about how to make a spread, how to make letters work together, how to make compositions. Then we had branding class to so everything like to build the pillars of a functional designer, a designer that can be hired to do a job. Not necessarily the most creative one, I think, but definitely the most employable one.
And yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, and it was a nice contrast from this. That was a technical degree. That wasn't a university. That was a technical degree. Mm-hmm. And then that's a nice contrast with my current university, with the William de Kooning Academy, because that is a very creative university. So they're making very creative designers. I am not sure if they're the most employable designers, but I'm sure that they're the most creative ones.
Yeah, like that's a really important first step. People don't realize these tools, like they're not just, you know, they assume, like you were saying earlier, your art, people think artist, designer are the same thing. And they think if you have a paintbrush and a pencil, you can do these, you can create the same kind of level stuff in these programs, but they're super technical, and the more you dive into it, the more you realize that you can do with it. And it's, you know, even I learned on the internet, but there's stuff that I know that I don't know, and I know that I can't do with some of these programs. So there's you're a technician, like a craftsman, that you have to learn the tools first before you can get to the like art or creative or like execution side of it.
Exactly. And there are things that I think you get. I think you can learn a program very well online. I think there are amazing tutorials on YouTube. God knows that I go to YouTube tutorials all the time, and I say, how do you free select hair on Photoshop again? Like, free tutorial, how do you do it? And I follow the steps and I do it, and then I forget and I do check it out again a month later. But to give you an example, there is this wonderful artist that I love. His name is Temi Coker. He is originally from Nigeria, but he's currently based in the US. His wife, Afritinia Coker, is one of my favorite photographers. I love her style. And he makes this very, he has his own style. He has an amazing style. And I always wonder how he does his patterns, because his pattern work is exquisite. And he has a class on Skillshare in which he teaches you how to do it. And I sat there and thought, how did this person discover this? This is fiddling with Photoshop for 10 years. Not 10, but maybe like for 2 years. Just fiddling, seeing how he can mix the processes, just creating processes and running them 20 times, getting that perfect amount of pixelation or of change in the form to get it to this particular shape. And I just learned how to do it in an hour because of this tutorial. So
yeah,
it's condensing that time into very little, into those 2 years into an hour class.
Yeah, man. Yeah, Skillshare is awesome. And I love that because there's like these people that are so specialized in something, and they can just go deep into like that thing that they know. Yeah,
that's so awesome. Yeah, and their mistakes. Like, they probably already did it wrong 40 times, and they're saving you all those mistakes.
Yeah. That's definitely, yeah, Skillshare. I'm not sponsored by them, but if whoever's listening, you're looking to learn something quick, go check out Skillshare.
Hey, if they want to sponsor you, would you say no to Skillshare if they wanted to sponsor you?
Hell no, I wouldn't say no. That would be awesome.
So let's put it out in the universe right now. Skillshare, listening to this, Josh will take a sponsorship.
Yes, I would. So yeah, I mean, Skillshare is great, but you know, you started off, you know, in these real, I say real institutions,
formal. Let's call it formal.
There you go. You got better words than me. As far as
I do have a podcast about it, so
yes, good. So you went from that one school to another school. What was the name of the second school that you went to in Germany?
This is the German one. The German one, it's called, I'm translating in my head. Communication school Lübeck. So Werkkunstschule Lübeck. So it's Working Art and Communication School of Lübeck. Yeah, that's, I can say it in German if you want to.
Do it.
Okay, in German, it's the Werkkunstschule Lübeck.
Cool.
I just said it very slowly to like get my pronunciation right. And then I graduated from that. I immediately got a job. Well, not immediately. Fairly quickly, I think like 2 months after graduation, I got a job in a very big tech company called Statista to do infographics. So I had found out in the Werkkunstschule, in my art school in Germany, that I loved infographics, that I really loved making complicated information easy to understand. So when I found Statista, I applied for a job, and they were looking for somebody who spoke Spanish and could do graphic design. So I was like, right there. And I was there for a year and a half. And during that time, I realized like, yeah, I like it here, but I don't love it. And I love my colleagues. Like what I'm doing. I love my friends here, but it's not necessarily what I want to do forever. And that's when I decided I want more. So I started researching and I found the Willem de Koenig Academy, which is the university in the Netherlands.
Ah, okay, cool. So yeah. So that's when you went to the Netherlands.
Yeah. And just like full disclaimer, I'm in no way trashing Statista. I think it was a great job. I still work for them. That's the thing, that I like them so much that they hire me as a freelancer and I still freelance for them.
Awesome.
But I think the key thing is that it's a job that's great. For example, for somebody who has kids, somebody that wants to show up at 8 a.m., know that they can leave at 5 p.m. and just leave their work at work. And yeah, for somebody in that position is great. But I was not in that position. I'm not in that position yet. So I wanted to do more and do more creative work and take more risks. And I went and took a giant one.
That's awesome. And so the school in the Netherlands, and forgive me if I can't pronounce them, but when you go there, you mentioned earlier that this is like a more artsy or more creative focus, like, is it like a culture shock when you go there?
Oh, totally. Totally, totally. So first of all, I didn't enter the school because of my portfolio. They actually hated my portfolio.
What?
Because my portfolio was really finished. Like, I had included my graduation project. I had included client work that I had done. I had included projects for other projects for university. And everything was very finished and very polished. They hated that. They wanted to see my process. They wanted to see journals full of scribbles and of my slow descent into madness. That's what they wanted to see. And me coming from a very formal German background or from a very square place, which is, Germany is very square. That's no point denying it. It is very square, at least where I was. I didn't show them that. So they, in my acceptance letter, they wrote, "Congratulations, we have accepted you. Just so you know, we hated your portfolio, but we really like your interview." And what? I thought, okay, I guess my mouth saved me again, repeating the story from when I was in school in Ecuador, when I went to the German school in Ecuador. My mouth saved me again. But yeah, it was a culture shock. To give you like an example, a lot of German things have rubbed off on me. For example, punctuality. I am very, my planner is very organized, and I am trying to be as punctual as possible. When I show up to my first day at the VDKA, that's what it's called, the university, I showed up there. I had to be there at 9. I was there like 10 to 9. And I was shaking. I was so nervous. I didn't know where to go. I didn't know what to do. I go to the front desk and tell them like, hey, it's my first day. I don't know what to do. And I'm already late. And the front desk lady, it's like, you're 10 minutes early. You're fine. Just chill. And I'm like, yeah, but I don't know where to go. And should I register somewhere? It's like, yeah, I'll take you to the auditorium. She takes me to the auditorium, and the presentation started at 9:30 because the Dutch are more loose when it comes to time. So, and everybody was so chill. They were like, yeah, like, 9:10, 9:15, you're fine. I'm like, no, it's not fine. It said at 9. Here it says 9. Why is nobody recognizing this?
That would bother me a little bit.
Yeah, but it's just the way they are. To give you another example, when I when you come to the Netherlands, when you move here, you have to sign up so people know. It's a European thing, actually. You have to go to your municipality, to your city hall, and say, like, hey, I live here now. And they give you a number, and you need that number to get a bank account, to do anything. You need that number. And when I showed up there, I looked at the documents they needed, and I told them, hey, so you want my birth certificate, but that says Ecuadorian. Do you also need my naturalization letter? Because everything needed to be translated, of course. So I wanted to know that if I had to pay the extra 100 euros to translate a document that was in German, or if it was fine that it was in German. The answer is, from the city, I don't know. I'm like, what? I said, I don't know. I'll go ask my manager. The manager comes. I don't know. What do you mean you don't know? Do you have to realize that I come from a place, from a country before that, where everything was known? If you go to Germany, for everything, there's a little booklet that has all the answers. And if that booklet doesn't have the answers, there's another booklet that has more specific answers. So somebody telling me, I don't know, was completely foreign to me. I wanted to lose my mind.
That's so funny. And I feel like, you know, in the U.S., it's that way because people just don't care. But it sounds like in this case, it was just like, just a cultural thing.
I don't know. I'm like, what do you mean you don't know? I need you to know this, lady. But it worked out. Like, I eventually adapted. And I'm like, okay, they're just more chill about it, in the sense that they will help you figure out a way. The thing about German, Dutch, and I'm guessing also like West European countries, Scandinavian countries, and so on, is that as long as they see you're taking initiative, they will help you. They were more than glad to help you. Like, last time I did my taxes in Germany, I think there's a huge difference with the U.S. In the U.S., you have to do your taxes yourself every year, right? So
yes, yeah.
In Germany, it works differently, that you don't have to do your taxes if you don't want to. So they will take your taxes off, your tax deductions, immediately from your paycheck before they give it to you. And then if you want money back, you do your taxes.
I see.
So let's say that they take, also taxes are super high. Let's say they take 40% of your paycheck from you. It's immediately out. You don't get 40%. And then let's say that year you applied for a new job. So you used money to find a new job. You bought yourself 500 euros worth in outfits for your new job. You do your taxes and you say, like, hey, I have this deductible. For my new job, I had to buy clothes. This is it. And they're also like, okay, cool. Here's your money back. But you have to do it. If you don't do it, they just keep your money. So a lot of people don't even bother doing it because it's very troublesome. So they just think, okay, cool. So the first time I did it, it was a nightmare and I couldn't do it right. And I had a friend help me. And the second time I did it, because I was leaving the country, I had more deductibles because I had like moving expenses and boxes and stuff like that. So I do it by myself. I find out the tax office is actually near my house. I didn't know that. That's how ill-informed I was. And I give them my papers and I'm like, here they are. The lady looks at me and says, this is all wrong.
Oh, man.
I'm like, what do you mean it's all wrong? It's like, you filled out all the wrong boxes. The amounts are completely incorrect.
No.
Make an appointment. Come back tomorrow. I have time at 10. We'll fill it out together. Don't worry about it. Because that's the thing. If they see you're trying, if they see you're putting effort in it, they will help you. They will more than gladly help you. They just need to know that you're trying.
That's so nice. Wow, that sounds like a really nice country now.
Yeah, it's really nice. It's a very great place to live. I think it's a great place to be a kid. Mm. And it's a really nice place to grow up. It's more diverse than people think it is.
Mm.
And yeah, there are so many things available to everybody. just, let me give you an example. So for example, in the Netherlands, I am a European citizen. I think it's because I'm a European citizen also. I can apply for a government relief, which is called a toeslag, which is if I make under certain amount, and I do because I'm a freelancer, so I make under certain amount, they're like, okay, your health insurance is, let's to say a number, $100 per month, let's say. We'll give you 75, so you don't have to worry about that. So you can just put up that 25. And I thought, that's a very nice thing. When do I have to give this money back? Because I'm guessing that I have to. And they told me, no, you don't have to give it back. It's fine.
Wow.
Yeah, my boyfriend was complaining about how high taxes are here, actually. And I thought, well, they're high because people like me need help paying their insurance. So the idea is that eventually I will not need this help anymore and they will charge me those very high taxes that I will gladly pay because it will help somebody else.
Yeah, no, that's awesome. That's the whole point of it, like trying to get everybody to a place where they're comfortable and they have the needs, and then if you don't, then you can help someone out, you know?
Yeah, exactly. So that's a beautiful thing. What I enjoy the most from living in Europe, or where I've lived in Germany and the Netherlands versus living in Latin America, that you see your taxes working. So that's what my father always said. He said, I'm paying crazy high taxes, but my sister went to medical school for 300 euros a semester. No, the year, 300 euros a year. And those are for, what's it called? Administrative expenses.
Wow. And that's like $200 or something like that, right?
Yeah,
or like...
pretty much. Yeah, $200 a year.
Jeez, that's awesome. Man.
Because it's subsidized by the government. My younger sister would have gone to public school there for, I think, $80, $70 a year.
And wow.
Getting everything, so like also quality education and so on.
That's really cool. So this, I feel like, so Netherlands sounds really cool, and so it sounds like you got situated into it pretty quickly, like learning everything, and how, you know, the culture there. But what about the school? Like, what kind of stuff are you learning there? You had told me one time that there's some really interesting education there.
Yeah. So what I think that differentiates the Verica A from my old school is, to give you an example, when we were learning printing techniques in my old school, we learned by examples. We learned, okay, this is silkscreen printing. This is what you can do with silkscreen printing. This is the history of silkscreen printing. This is a YouTube video of how it's done. Here's a book of how people did it. You can touch it. You can feel it. You can see what was done with it. In this current school, it's more of, here's a silkscreen machine. Here are the paintings. Here's an assignment. Figure it out. What? Really? Or a riso printer or a laser cutter. It's everything set up available to you. And yeah, just experiment, do things, figure it out. And then it goes to teach each other. Then it's like, you're going to be set up in pairs now. You have to combine your techniques. You have to teach each other. So I was taught how to silkscreen by one of my friends. She taught me how to do it. And then if you want to learn something else, let's say if you are curious about voiceover or audio design, you can go to the audiovisual station and say, I want to learn this. Where's the workshop? There's a workshop there. You can learn how to use the equipment and then you can use it. Or we also have material station, in which you have wood, ceramics, metal. And if you want to learn how to weld, you can learn how to weld. This is, I'm going to teach you in an hour and then you're going to do whatever you want.
Wow, that's so cool. And some people might react to that like, well, what's the point of, like, why am I paying this school if they're not going to instruct me? But that's actually a great way to learn, and especially considering that a lot of this equipment is super expensive. So even just getting access to this equipment is a big deal.
Yeah, that's the thing. Therefore, to give you an example, a riso printer is between 15 and 20,000 euros. And in the school, we get to use it as much as we want to. And then without counting the cartridges, like I think a cartridge is like 500 euros. It's like, yeah, just I book it for an hour. I want to experiment for an hour. So it's all the access to those things. And then also you have the tutors at the stations who are specialists in that subject. So if you tell them, I want to try this out, they will be, they, most of the time they'll say, okay, here are the equipments, do it. And then 60% of the time, 50% of the time, they'll look at you saying, like, that sounds so cool. Let's do it together. And they'll do it with you. They'll experiment with you. They'll, there is one instructor in the wood station. I will go to war for that woman. She has saved me from cutting my fingers off so many times. She has saved projects of mine, and she's just a wealth of knowledge. And I will go to war for her. And she's actually doing a master's degree in the university on sustainable creative businesses. So she's also a student in the university. And yeah, she's amazing. And it's that access to those people. And I think also the key difference is that the teachers that in your regular classes, they not only give you assignments that are very challenging, but they also push you to like push yourself. Like there are teachers that you are just, don't look at me. This is a visual podcast and you're going to put this on YouTube so people can see me doing that. For those who can't, I'm doing a hand gesture, hiding my face from the teacher. That you'll be like, don't look at me, don't look at me. And then others that will tear your work apart, but also make you want to redo it. Be like, they were so right. I can redo this in a very, like taking your Legos, putting them apart, and then encouraging you to put them back together again.
In a better way, like sort of.
In a way that you maybe never saw coming. To give you an example, I actually, when the pandemic hit, it was like right at the beginning of the school term, and I failed that term at university. I actually failed it. Like, I couldn't focus on the philosophical idea of what plastic is because I was too worried about a global pandemic. So,
yeah.
Potato, patata, I guess. We had different priorities in that moment. So I failed it. And then I had to, what they do is that they don't have to, you don't have to redo it, but you have to do a project to do something called a reset, in which you don't have to repeat the project that you failed, but you have to take the feedback they give you and make a new project. So I decided I'm going to take this feedback, I'm going to combine it with an elective that I took called biomimicry, and I'm going to make a new project. And the project that came out of that is something I don't think I would have been capable or even have thought of if I hadn't gone to this university.
Wow. And what was the project? Can you describe it in words?
The one that passed me, yeah. So I took this class called biomimicry. I became very curious about fungi, or fungi, whatever, however you want to pronounce it. And I realized, and I made a project about how biomimicry is integrated into our society today in ways that we don't even notice, To give you an example, I actually took a fungi and I looked at a pattern that it made. And the pattern reminded me of camouflage. And then I realized, okay, camouflage is biomimicry. We just no longer see it as biomimicry. We see it as a pattern. Like in fashion, we see it as a pattern. We don't think it's supposed to mimic nature. So I started looking into deep archives of anthropology, trying to find how we got into the things that we got. So for example, there are temples in Asia that are encrusted into walls, and it's because we're mimicking what caves are. There is this, and there's a lot of suppositions. So there are things that we will never know because they're undocumented. For example, there is this tribe native to Africa in which they paint themselves red with mud to protect from the sun. And it's integrated into their society. It's in their hair, it's in their clothing. Everything they have is red. And then you also see elephants doing this. So it's completely undocumented. We don't know. But maybe at some point we looked at what elephants were doing, protecting themselves from the sun with this red clay. And we mimic them, and now today we're still doing it. And then you go into how Velcro was discovered. Velcro was also biomimicry. Then how, going to today, how swimwear for swimmers is actually based off the skin of sharks, how it has little channels to make that more aquadynamic. And then into the future of how we're going to keep mimicking nature for building structures or for, like, actually they're now looking into how termites built their little termite castles that are all, that are actually, I think, 10 degrees cooler than the outside is because of how they're built. And we're looking into that to see how we're going to build the buildings in the future so they won't need air conditioning, but they will, like, self-regulate temperature. So I did an entire timeline with it, a website, and it was reactive, and I put all my research together in a visual way and, like, cataloged it by documented, undocumented, confirmed, unconfirmed, and so on.
Wow, that's so cool. That's so cool. And like, I think that's a really important part of design and the future of science and art and the way and design and the, and how they're going to melt together. Because there's this one lady at MIT. Have you heard of her? In the States, she's leading their, like, their, like, design lab, and they're all about creating new materials, but in a way that is also appealing to people.
Is her the one that looked at silkworms?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, I know. I saw her TED Talk, and I actually, like, included her in my timeline. Her name escapes me right now because I'm terrible at names, but I know who you're talking about, and yeah, she's great.
Yeah, it is great. No, that's a really cool project. And so you said that if you didn't take some of these classes, you wouldn't have come up with this final project at your time in the Netherlands at the school. What did you learn about yourself that you didn't expect to?
About myself that I didn't expect to? That's a good question. I think it was a combination from being in the school and being outside of the school. So when I moved here, I decided that I thought, okay, I'm starting university when I'm 26. I don't want to have this huge gap on my resume. And I also thought, okay, when I graduate, my classmates are going to have an edge over me in the sense that they're younger. So, and I decided that I was going to freelance. So I started freelancing. So my 4 years in university are 4 years of freelancing. And it was a lot of balls to juggle. Some of them are in glass and some of them are rubber and some fall and they're perfectly fine. Some fall or shatter into a million pieces. But I think I learned that I can be resilient, that I can, I don't know. I think sounds braggy, but I think that I can put up with a lot more than I thought I could put up with.
That's awesome.
Yeah, I remember, like, my classmate, like, one classmate of mine who I love dearly, like, she's a great person, I love her, but she would come up to me and say, like, I'm having a mental breakdown, this is too much, and I would just look at her and think, you're only doing this, you're only doing university. I have a base, like, I am doing university and I am working an insane amount of hours because also I love saying yes to things. I love saying yes to new projects. And I'm like, yeah, I'm going to do this new project. I don't know where I'm going to get time. Doesn't matter. I will give up sleep. And yeah, so when she came up to me and said, like, I'm having a mental breakdown, I'm like, oh, then what am I having then? then who am I?
Yeah. And that's like, that sounds like the word I want to use is grit.
Yeah.
You know, and there's a book about called Grit by Angela Duckworth. I haven't fully read it, but I watched her TED Talk and some of her stuff in this. And it's all about how, like, grit is one of the most important things historically for people as far as their level of success that they can reach. And so it sounds like you definitely have that.
I hope so. And also, the thing is that when I was I felt like I couldn't give up and that I wasn't, that I had to keep doing it. And every time that it got hard, I started thinking about my mom, because my mom also had kids, then stayed at home with us, and then she went to university when my sister and I were already in school. So I thought, okay, when she was in university as well, same age that I was, she goes, not only doing university, but also taking care of an 8-year-old and a 9-year-old and her husband. And we only had one car. So she had to drive us all everywhere to and making sure that we all were healthy, we're fed, we're happy, with all our parts still attached, and taking care of school. And she graduated the best of her class.
Wow.
So, yeah, so every time that it got hard for me, I started thinking like, okay, inside, channel her, channel her.
Yeah. I mean, the parents can do that. They definitely, it's looking back, I think every kid, if they have some kind of insight and empathy for people, they realize how crazy it is to raise kids and raise you, like looking back on your own self, like, oh damn, they went through that.
Yeah. You know what? I've had a lot of those moments now that, because my parents had us so young, I knew very early on that I didn't want to have kids as young as my parents did, because I figured all the things that I want to do, like, I don't know, going to a bar at 8 p.m., they couldn't do because they had two little kids at home. And they had to grow up earlier. They had to grow up quicker. And I realized, okay, I want to have those freedoms. I want to experience that. So I don't want to have kids when I'm young. And then so my dad, when he was my age, he had an 8-year-old and a 9-year-old. And I keep thinking, what would I do with an 8-year-old and a 9-year-old? I love them I love kids to death, but I ask myself, what would I do with them? What do they do?
Yeah, man. Yeah, my younger brothers both have, at least one's the oldest on for one of my brothers, 7. The oldest for
you
the other.
You just forget how many nieces and nephews you have?
No, I just forget the age. I know that. Between them, they have 6 kids, and so they got a lot. And
I know they exist. They just needed a second to remind how old they are.
Yeah, no, the oldest, my brother has a daughter that's much older than my other brother's son. He just turned 7, so I'm trying to do the math anyway. So that makes her like 11. Anyway, so yeah, they're younger than me, and their kids are this age, and I'm like, whoa, I would not, you know, having kids that age are crazy for me.
That's the thing, that so when my younger sister was born when I was 12, so I remember the day she was born. I remember helping to take care of her. I remember changing her diapers. I remember her rolling over, playing with her. I remember all those things. Again, I wasn't like super attached to her until she was like 6. I loved her because she was my sister, but I wasn't super, I like you as a person until she was like 6. That was when we got really close, and those when we became tight. Like, I'm very honest about it. I had a biological bond with her and she was fun, but I didn't bond with her like completely until she was a lot older, or 6 older. Yeah, until she was older. And the thing is that now when I started university and my classmates are so much younger than me, they said like, wow, you're 26, you're gonna be the mom of the class. And I'm like, can I curse in this podcast?
Yeah.
Okay, my answer was fuck no. Fuck no. I am in here for myself. I am not going to take care of anybody. No. And then that was one, or the other one, that the other comment I heard was, oh my God, when I am 26, like, I want to be married with 2 kids.
Jeez.
And my answer is always, I will lend you my niece and my nephew for an afternoon, and you tell me if you still want to have kids after. Now, I love them dearly. They're 2 of my favorite kids on this earth. I enjoy them thoroughly. But I also enjoy Netflix. I also enjoy being able to just, at 8 p.m., say like, okay, I'm going to just watch TV for 4 hours. Or wake up on a Saturday at 11 a.m. and do nothing but, I don't know, fiddle in my computer. Or go outside and enjoy the weather. Or do whatever I want without having somebody's survival rely on myself.
Yeah, that's definitely I want to be a kid for a lot longer myself, so I'm definitely not gonna have kids.
That's the thing, and I think also in Latin American culture, maybe you know that as well, that there is this pressure to have kids, to be kids are such, and I think kids are a wonderful thing, but I also think that kids should come to people who actually want them. Mm-hmm. I have had this conversation with people many times, in the sense that when they ask me, when are you going to have kids? And I tell them, I am right now not in a position in which I can fulfill the needs of a child. It's the way that I see it. Many times people have kids because, to give you an example, because they want to experience what it's like to be pregnant. To me, that is putting a desire that you have above the needs of somebody else. Because pregnancy is 9 months, and then you have a person who's going to eventually be an adult. Can you fulfill the needs of a little person?
Yeah.
If you can, amazing. Have a child. If you're going to love it, amazing. Have a child. If it's just something that you want to feel and you want to have 9 months of bliss, even though I personally think pregnancy is a train wreck. Sounds awful to me. Sounds weird. Another topic. I think that's a very personal decision. And if somebody doesn't want to have children, that's good for them. I'm not going to force them to have children either.
Yeah. I think people, I mean, as a society, it seems like it's standard to practice to be asking that, not only in Latin America, but in the States. Like, the way that it's phrased is, when are you going to have kids? And it really, like you said, it's very private. And if you're going to ask anything, it should be, do you want to have kids? Because that's the real question. Like, me and Christine don't even want kids, like, looking forward. So that question's always funny. And it's, you don't necessarily have to have kids.
Exactly. And then as a woman, you get asked, but your clock, your biological clock, you're going to regret it not having kids when you're older. Figured if that happens, there are other paths to having children. Mm-hmm. There's something called foster care. There's something called adoption. There are so many kids all around the world who want nothing more than parents. And if you want the biological aspect, there's also solutions to that.
Definitely.
Yeah, that's the thing. I'm the type of person that I want to be a parent. That's something that I want to be. I want to shape another human being. It's going to sound corny, but I think I got this magical childhood. I was always safe. I was always loved. I was never afraid to go home. I never saw violence in my house. My parents, if they had arguments, they never had them in front of us. My dad never disrespected my mom. My mom never disrespected my dad in any way. And there are two people who are insanely in love with each other. Until this day, they're disgustingly in love. And I want to be a parent because I want to give that to somebody else. And I want to adopt. I actually want to do foster care and adoption one day, because I know that there are kids out there, they're praying that the only thing they want is to have somebody that looks at them and sees that the sun sets and rises because they exist. And that's the reason that I want to be a parent. Pregnancy is a train wreck to me. I don't look at pregnant women and say, I want that. I look at them and I get panic attacks. I avoid my friends when they're like in the 8th month of pregnancy, 9th. I avoid them because my friend Jenna, actually, she got huge. And I just looked at her and thought, I'm not ready. What if this kid comes now? I don't know what to do. Should I watch a video on YouTube real quick to know how to bring a person into the planet? I don't know. I am not ready. So I just started avoiding her.
Hey, that's a solution. Hey, more power to you. I don't think that's a bad choice at all. I think, I definitely don't think it looks like a day in the park to be pregnant. And Christine feels the same way. She doesn't want to be pregnant. And I think the stigma behind, I feel like there's a stigma behind adoption. And I think, you know, talking about it, I think, you know, moves us towards getting rid of that. And that is such a big option. And if we ever do have kids, I think we would end up adopting them as well.
Yeah, and a huge part of the stigma is thinking that they're damaged goods. Like if they, or thinking that if kids are in foster care, it's because they're dangerous. And the truth is that no child is in foster care because of something they did. Right. They're in foster care because of a variety. There's a mirage. There is a huge amount of reasons why a child can be in foster care. And in the end, they're kids. They're, whether they come, if they come from a situation of abuse, then they need more safety. Then they need more security. Then say like, oh, but then you're taking a child who maybe was abused in some way. It's like, that's not a reason. That's a reason to not leave them there. That's a reason to give them a safe place so they can be productive human beings. So they can, and by productive, I mean, so they're, not that they're productive to society and they're little machines to serve society, so that they can protect other human beings later. It's that. And it's saying like, oh, if you adopt, it's because you cannot have kids yourself. It's like, maybe I don't want to have biological children. And yeah. My dad, because he's a very like old school Latin American guy sometimes, he says like, he always tells me, but my genetic material, but the amazing combination that you and your mother made, so you guys came out, what's going to happen there? And I just tell him every time I tell him, I think there are 56 other things that you gave me that have nothing to do with my genetic material that way more valuable. Like they gave me a work ethic. They gave me respect for others. They gave me curiosity. They gave me safety. They gave me all those things that I think are stronger in their legacy than my genes. So, and who knows, maybe I'll have a biological one for shits and giggles.
Yeah.
Be like, God damn it, birth control failed. Now I have to do this. And I'll complain 99% of the time.
Yeah, I bet. No, that's really cool. That's very admirable. And yeah, I agree. And in reality, we're all genetically, you know, cousins. We're anyway.
Basically all the same. It's the variations in the genetic material from one person to the other. Like, yes, people get caught by DNA, like people, criminals get caught by DNA evidence. Yes. But in the end, we're all humans.
Mm-hmm. So, I mean, sounds like you want to do some cool things, you know, as far as like having a kid and adopting in the future. After graduating, it sounds like you went into straight like freelance. What do you like?
I haven't graduated yet. I'm starting my fourth year.
Oh, you haven't graduated?
No, I'm starting my fourth year at university now. Wow. I know what I want to do afterwards. Like, I want to go into service design. There are a lot of very interesting service design agencies in the Netherlands and abroad. So ideally, I would go for an agency called IDEO, which is an American agency led by Tim Brown, and he has a base in Munich. So I speak German, so maybe it's destiny. But some of the projects that I've done, I am currently working with the city of Rotterdam on a project to create a sense of belonging inside the city hall by bringing the people that were, by involving the people who work in the city hall in this project. So when I started it, I knew from the beginning that I wanted it to be, so Rotterdam has a very high, I think it's 10% of the population who is functionally illiterate, meaning that they don't know how to read and write, but they function. So I knew that I wanted to do something for people who are challenged in their levels of communication. And that doesn't necessarily mean that they're immigrant. That can also mean that they have a disability that limits their communication skills, that they're fresh immigrants, can mean that they're poor. There's a lot of reasons why somebody can be functionally illiterate. And then, I mean, I'm illiterate when it comes to binary code. I cannot read binary. I cannot read Java. So I'm illiterate that way too. And so the project started with defining what being illiterate is. And then it went on to asking the people who work in the city hall that have day-to-day contact with visitors, what they're missing, what they need, what they would like to create in to turn the city hall into a space in which somebody that doesn't speak Dutch or cannot communicate correctly or in a, at the same level as they can feel comfortable. So that's something that I'm working on with them. I'm also developing with a friend a emotional agility tool for children that should, we hope that it would help kids communicate, understand and communicate their emotions without using words. And those are two projects that I'm currently working on, aside from doing university and doing my own freelance and keeping a relationship going and being close to my family. So essentially, I don't sleep. Oh, and having a podcast.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
And, yeah, that's a lot.
Yeah, and the emotional agility tool, it's really cool. It's I'm working with a friend on this. She's a teacher. And she came to me with the idea saying, like, I want to do something. I want to develop a product. I really don't know what. So it was first looking into what fascinates both of us, what we're interested in, and then coming up with this idea. And that is hopefully going to be my graduation project. And I want it to be not just a concept and development, but also how to take it into market. Because we have talked about a couple of psychologists, and they think it would be interesting not only for children, but also for adults, for people that come in refugee situations, for people that come from trauma and abuse, and yeah, just for people who don't understand emotions.
Which is a lot of people.
Yeah, and it has a lot to do with the fact that when we're little, we're taught that there are good emotions and bad emotions. Mm-hmm. That if you are happy, you look this way, and when you're sad, you look that way. But that doesn't apply to everybody. So some people, when they're angry, they're very abrasive and they're very loud. Other people pull back when they're angry. Some people, when they're happy, they're very jolly. Others can be happy and calm. So the idea of the tool is that it allows you to experience things in your body, because a kid will not understand what anxiety is, but you feel emotions in your body first. And also kids between the ages of 2 and 7, they don't understand abstracts. If you tell them, there's this very interesting book called Is Daddy Coming Home Yet? No, it's Is Daddy Coming Home Soon? And it's about a woman whose husband dies suddenly. And she has to explain to her 3-year-old son that his dad has died. And she wrote the book for him because she kept telling him dad went to heaven. But because he's 3, he doesn't understand abstracts. So for him, it's like, oh, so he's coming back soon. When is he coming back from heaven? Or, no, your daddy went the way of your doggy. Oh, so when is he coming back with the dog? Or is he in a farm? Or all those things. So the book is a way to explain to him, with things that he can see, what death is. And that's the idea of our tool as well, that kids can identify in their bodies an emotion and also understand that other people feel emotions in a very different way than they do. So get them in tune with that. And if somebody is a refugee, for example, who doesn't speak the language, how can we use this tool to help them tell us what they feel and what they need?
Wow. And that's all for the city of Rotterdam?
No, that's a private project. For the city, it's an environment. It's a whole, so everything is linked to communication in somehow. But for the city is an environment that the host can manipulate, that can be made by them. It's really weird. It's these booths that have animations and projections inside of them that a person that's feeling anxious, for example, can go into while they wait for their services to relax and to feel like they belong, to create a safe space inside a stressful environment.
Interesting. So you're talking about, you're going to be studying service design, but you're already doing it.
Yeah, so I already like this is my final year, so I've been doing it for a while now. So I've been doing it for like, I've been, aside from like reading my, like in the university, service design was something that I discovered through the university, and then just experiencing it, and now I'm just experimenting with what I want to do. And then so when I graduate, I can be like, hey, I did all these things also, like look at these projects that I made, just hire me please. And yeah, I realized that it felt to me, like I still, when I do freelance design, I still like do logos and do graphics and do business cards and stuff like that. I really enjoy doing that. Mm-hmm. But I feel like I'm really passionate. Like that's where, in service design, that's where my passion is. That's where I'm like, I want to solve this problem.
No, and that's really cool. And people don't really think about it this way, especially in the public sector, like the services that we ask our government to do for us. They might not always have the right insight as to how to create those in a way that is going to be effective and in a way that people can actually get the benefits that they want from it and they need from it. So, and I feel like we've been saying the word service design for a while. Can you break down that title
a
little bit?
So service design is designing a solution, and a service can be tangible or non-tangible. So a service can be, to give you an example, let's say you go to the hospital and you have to do the sign up and so on, and then you're taking from the waiting room to the diagnostic room, okay? So the hospital can be, go to the service designer and say, we want to know what's a better way to improve that patient's transition from being in the waiting room to being in the treatment room or in the diagnostic room. So it'd be like, what do you need? It can be that you need an app. Most times it's not going to be that. It can be, okay, we can create an environment for you. How can we enrich this experience? So it's essentially creating experiences that can improve people's life or lead to a target, to a targeted thing, to a targeted outcome. Maybe you want a service that will improve the productivity of your workers. So you have to go in and ask them, okay, where are the pain points? Where are the potholes? How can we work in this together? And it's using design thinking to come up with innovative solutions. And I think, like, right now, a problem is a lot of people think that things are going to be solved by an app. Like, the solution is many times very simply, oh, let's do an app. And it's maybe many times it's not going to be an app. To give you an example, earlier this year, I was involved in a project that ended because we didn't get funding for it, in which was creating a service for refugees to be able to give them information about services they might need when they arrive into Spain. So in the south of Spain, there's a huge amount of refugees that arrive there. And then before they're sent to their next destination, which is usually a city that they're assigned to, they wait in a particular city for a while. And then the question is, if they're a woman that needs gynecological care, where can she go? If they're a family, where can they go? If they're a man who wants to know as well Spanish classes, where can he go? And for a lot of people, the solution was like, let's make an app. And I said, okay, if you make an app, it means that you have a phone. It means that you have a charger for your phone and you have access to electricity. It means that you have enough data in your phone to download an app, or you have access to Wi-Fi. It means that you have a phone that, like, I have an iPhone S. Clubhouse is no longer able to download in this phone because it doesn't update anymore.
Oh, wow. I didn't know that.
So, yeah. So if I have a phone that's older than this and the app is made, of course, for the latest version of the phones, then it's not, I cannot download it anymore. What if the person is over 60 and they don't know how to download an app?
Or they got a flip phone.
Or they got a flip phone. That's also something that can happen. What if they didn't come here? What if they came here with nothing? Immediately, this is not accessible to them.
Mm-hmm.
So then a service designer could get involved and say, like, okay, I'm going to ask refugees, what do they need? They trust a lot of word of mouth, for example. They're more likely to go to a service that is recommended by one of their peers or somebody that's like them than go to a service recommended by the government. Then how do we put together a network? If we're sending them somewhere, we need a way to confirm that the places we're sending them are safe, that they provide quality of care. You are not going to send somebody, like, right now that's escaping Afghanistan to a place when they only speak Farsi, or to an association that only has people who speak Farsi. They need to speak Afghani. So how do we create this network? And the idea was to create a network and then find refugees that are not freshly arrived that can help us spread the word of mouth to freshly arrived refugees. So create a network system that went beyond an app. And also, they're not going to use an app. Maybe, like, it's going to be a booklet. Maybe it's going to be a set of cards. Maybe it's going to be something that they can share with each other, something that's accessible. So that's basically what service design is. It's looking at a problem and finding a creative solution to it that it's not only innovative, but also something that can be implemented.
Wow, that's really cool. And that's something I've never heard of. It sounds a little bit like like you said, it's not, takes into account the whole design thinking approach, which my experience with UX design and interviewing, you know, users for an interface eventually or anything. It sounds very similar to that, but in this case, something that's going to be more tangible in person. And it sounds like there's a lot of applications for not only public, but also private sector, you know, solutions.
Yeah, of course. So to give you an example of a private company that does this, there is a, it's called Life Bank Africa. Yeah, I have it on my phone. It's called Life Bank Africa. It's owned by, I don't want to butcher her name. I made a post about it on Instagram and I have her name here and I really don't want to butcher it because I admire her a lot and I actually voted for her, but I don't want to mispronounce her last name. She is right now actually up for an award as Innovative Africans Under 30. And she is the head of Life Bank Africa. And where are you? Oh, the beauty of editing. Yeah. It's Temi Jiwa Tubuzon. I can say the name. She's the founder of Life Bank Nigeria, actually. And what she is native from Nigeria. Her parents migrated to the U.S. And when she went back to Nigeria as an adult, after getting her degree in the management of NGOs, she realized that women in Nigeria, in rural areas, were dying because there wasn't any blood. So they were given birth and just bleeding out on the table. And there was nothing that could be done because there wasn't any blood. So she, with her NGO background, she realized that there's not much that she can do. So she decided to open a private company called Life Bank Africa, in which they deliver blood in the same way that Uber delivers food.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So a hospital can actually order blood that will be delivered from different parts of the country, basically by bike, just like Uber delivers food. And,
oh my gosh, that's cool.
Yeah, and they get the blood from communities and they pay people to do the blood donations and they provide HIV tests. So they're also helping people know their status when it comes to HIV in exchange for a small fee. Like the people get paid a small fee and they donate blood. And that is just working as a private company, she can do all those things. As an NGO, she wouldn't be able to pay them.
Wow. And so she got consulting from a service designer, or was she a service designer herself?
I think she got consulting from a service designer. So she analyzed the problem from her stance, and then she found a designer to help her create the infrastructure of her business. And then she got a business consultant to help her set it up and stuff like that. So it's an involvement of a lot of different people. And that's something that I love about service design as well, that it requires a lot of parts. And it involves a lot of people. And in the sense that if you're going to approach a problem in, let's say, to go back to example of making the experience of a hospital better, it's not only designers. It also involves patients. It involves doctors. It involves nurses. It involves people from management. It's all getting together from their different stands and approaching the problem from their different standpoints.
Wow, that's awesome. Yeah, and I never heard about it. And I bet there's a lot of people that haven't heard about it. So hopefully that shines light to like this whole branch of design that you can get into that is so human oriented. And yeah, Sounds like there could be a lot of benefits, you know, anywhere it's being used.
Yeah. If anybody's curious, I mean, some books that I could recommend, one is called Service Design Doing. It was written in total by 200 people.
Wow.
It's a great book. It's called Service Design Doing. It's really good. It has a lot of case studies. It's very detailed in the process. And they always say that they provide a framework, but you can do with it whatever you want. So that's a great book, Service Design Doing. It's really interesting. There's another book called Change by Design by Tim Brown, who is the founder of Ideo, in which he stays within the frame of Ideo talking about case studies. But it's really interesting, and it explains how different people can come together to figure out the solution to a problem. So those are two books that are really good. And then there is another one that is from the same people that did Service Design Doing, but it's called Service Design Thinking. And they go more deep into the process of design thinking and how creative professions can translate from thinking about concepts to actually doing concepts.
Wow, that's so cool. That is so cool. So sounds like you got another year left from school.
Yeah.
What do you want to be doing in the future?
Well, in the future, my plan, my immediate plan is that I want to graduate and I want to start a company with my friend Edna, who is with whom I'm doing the emotional agility tool. And I want that to be a business that she runs. I want to be co-founder, but she runs it because she has gone to be the teachers and that's her passion. Like that's her baby, the project. I am collaborating with the project and I'm very passionate about it. But I want her to run that company. I want that problem to stay with her. So I want to do that as soon as I graduate. And then I would like to go work for a service design agency and do that, or for the city or for Rotterdam, and then be able to, yeah, use design thinking to help people. Then maybe switch countries again. I'm not sure. If Ideo offered me a job, I would switch countries in a heartbeat. Just have to convince my boyfriend to do the same, so.
Ideo, that's one of the companies?
Yeah.
The service design companies?
Yeah. It's a really interesting company. They have done amazing work, and yeah. They will be lucky to have me. No, I'm just kidding. Just kidding. I'm not that arrogant. But yeah, it sounds like it aligns very well, I think, like with my values and everything. So I'll be very excited to work there. If I cannot do any of those things, I don't know, open my own service design agency maybe. Eventually I want to be able to run projects in Latin America. So it's something that I really want to do. I think there are a lot of problems in Latin America that need attention, that maybe bringing in a creative focus, financial focus also. I'm one of those people that don't think NGOs can do everything. If NGOs could fix all the problems in the world, they would have done it already. I think private businesses need to also be a part of it. And something like, there's a certification that I want to do. It's called Impact Economics with Stuart Williams, who I found on Clubhouse, actually. And it's the idea that people can solve their problems. You just need to give them the system to do it. So he always says that the second we take down our feet from their throats and we let them thrive, they will thrive. So create systems or create companies or create advances that can help people in Latin America. There's one, for example, it's called Black Manta. It's a company in Spain, in the south of Spain, yeah. There were a lot of people that were selling goods on the street, like bags and purses and in free markets and so on. So what Black Manta did is he got them all under a co-op. So they got to organize their finances better. They got to figure out a system so they don't have to be 7 days a week there. They share into the income, they share into the expenses. So basically got 250 small business owners, informal business owners to formalize under this co-op. And they're all doing great now, making legitimate businesses. The police cannot come in close. So,
wow, that's pretty cool. Yeah, that sounds really. You never think about that, creating a co-op between different businesses to fund that kind of thing.
Yeah, especially because you have so many informal businesses in Latin America, and it's so disorganized. But it maybe there's a way to create a system in which they can all like exist without under one umbrella. More legitimately, according to the government's eyes, so maybe that could help, or just maybe do what Temi did and figure out a safer way of women to have children in Latin America, or figure out a way that resources can be established but can be scattered better. I don't know. Like, choose a problem. Like, it's in service design, it's called wicked problems. Find a wicked problem and try to offer a creative solution to it.
Wow. Yeah. And there's a lot of wicked problems in a lot of
In a lot of parts of the world, but I keep thinking, okay, I speak Spanish and I come from there, so I guess I'll start there.
Hell yeah, no, definitely, and they could use you. They could use someone like you. And so would that be, the question that I have was going to be like, what's your dream project to work on in the service design industry? Do you think that would be it, like, or would it be something else?
My dream project, that's a tricky question. Right now, the emotional agility tool is my dream project, and setting up that company and being able, like, I keep telling Edna that, or not Edna, she actually agrees with me, but other people, and they told me, like, what do you want us to be? And I keep telling them, honestly, if I make a thing and it helps one kid express themselves and make sure that other people understand them, I'll be happy. If one kid is able to say to his parents how they feel using this tool, or explain to their teacher how they feel, or make their emotions more clear, then I'm happy. If it works for one, it will work for 10. If it works for 10, it will work for 20, and so on. So right now, that is my dream, getting that set up, make it a business, a sustainable business that actually works.
Yeah.
And then I'll figure out the next dream after that.
That's really cool. You're living the dream.
Kind of, I guess. Not yet. We're working towards that. We're walking ahead towards the dream.
Yeah.
And I also want to have a dog. That's also part of the dream, having a dog. That's also there.
There you go. Dogs are important. I love dogs.
Dogs are always a dream.
Cool. So yeah, I think we're getting towards the end of the time. And it's been great. I definitely learned a lot of cool stuff from you. And go ahead.
Happy that you learned that.
Oh, okay. Sorry. No, definitely learned a lot of cool stuff, not only about you, about the stuff you're doing and service design. But at this point, like where would my audience be able to find you, and where can they learn more about you?
Well, I have a website called June10th.site. It's like June, like the month, 10th, like 10th.site. That's going through a redo. Like, I'm going to redo it because I want it to be more focused towards service design. So that's going to have a redo. But also I'm on Instagram as the official June 10th. I'm sure that everything is going to be in the show notes, so I don't need to spell it. And then I also have a podcast called Do I Need School to Be, in which Josh is actually one of my guests. We have to talk about that. It's a really fun show in which I interview people in the creative field about how they got into the field and who were their teachers and how they think education will go in the future. Because let's face it, creative education hasn't changed much. For something that's creative, it's not very changing. So, yeah. And in no way we're trashing formal education. In no way. I mean, I got formal education and I loved it. So, but we're all different. And in my episode with you, we actually talk about the difference between being self-taught and formal education and what could be improved there. And how you're a Renaissance man, but not like Leonardo da Vinci. You actually told me about a character from the Aztecs, I think.
Uh-huh. No, Nezahualcóyotl.
Yes, that one, whose name I still cannot pronounce. but yeah, it's a really fun show that's called Do I Need School to Be? The link on Instagram is Dean School to Be as the letter. Yes, the name was not available. But yeah, that's when you can find me, and on Instagram as well. And yeah.
Awesome. Cool. Well, thanks again for joining. I definitely enjoyed my time again with you. Yeah, this is our second time, you know, doing podcasts together. So,
yay, everyone. Podcasters of the world, unite!
Yes, ma'am. But yeah, I'll go ahead and stop recording. But yeah, thanks a lot.
Thank you for having me. Thank you.